So when would you pay your stock pigeons up, Brian, to breed quite a few youngsters? Because you always like a lot of youngsters to go through your hands to find a few. So when would you pay your stock birds up?
I pay my stock pigeons up in the middle of January.
You don't pay up in like your December like some do?
No.
Always middle of January.
I find them pigeons, I've done it, don't get me wrong, I've paired up end of November.
Yes.
And just get rings on them.
I've got you, yeah, when you get them, yeah.
At one time, I mean, I could have got rings at 10th one year, I went to Belgium and got some rings. And rung them with Belgium rings and then transferred them.
Right.
But I found out them pigeons are never any good. They might be good young birds, but they never carry on.
So you better, you would say, before Blackpool, about 15th of January,
yeah.
You'd pair all your stock
birds before
up,
Blackpool, right, yeah.
And would your race birds all be paired roughly at the same time and then transfer your best?
No, what I do, there's three racing lofts.
Yes.
And I'll pair one racing loft up with them, with them
stock birds on the 15th of, roughly the 15th, yeah, of January.
Yeah.
Yeah. Would you float some of them?
And then the stock birds' eggs goes under them.
Under them, you probably, they would be probably, yeah, yearlings, wouldn't they, Brian?
Yeah, that's
probably
right.
Not bothered about much of them.
Well, when I say, I pair one and a half lofts up.
Yes.
And then 10 days later.
So we're talking beginning of
February.
Well,
sorry, 20 days later. Because
probably 5th or 6th of February, you'll be pairing your next loft up.
That's right.
Right. Then would you pay your next loft up about Valentine's Day, Brian?
And then I take the eggs again.
Right.
So I let my stock birds lay twice with a 10-day rest.
Yes.
You know, I let her then lay. She sits eggs 10 days and take eggs away.
Take eggs
and
away.
And let her go down again, and yes, then she can do that twice, and then I let her rear a third round of youngsters.
I've got you. And what about the actual? You know your latest racing loft, Brian, for flying all your national races right through to 500. When would they be paired up? At your latest date of your pairing of your racing pigeons?
Our latest date will be...
Of your three sheds?
Be about first week in February.
Right, 5th of February,
something like that, yeah.
And that would be ideal to fly all the way through, yeah, the programme, yeah, to July.
I've flown, yeah, our way through... I always used to, when I had a lot less pigeons when I was working, I used to pair everything up on 23rd of January. And,
right.
And I remember sending a cock to 500 mile and he top fed. And he cast his first flight the morning I basketed to go to 500 miles.
So that were roughly Wednesday, would it be Wednesday for 500 then?
Wednesday, it was Wednesday.
So he'd only just be probably busted on liberation or not even piped through?
He wouldn't be piped through, no.
So it just shows you that pigeon, most fancies would say it would be sore, that pigeon never made any detriment.
I don't think it does, personally.
So it's pigeon at the end of the day?
I don't think them first two or three flights bothers a pigeon.
No. Are you a big believer in wings then, Brian? Because some people say they don't look at these wings and they're not bothered. They are you a big believer that nothing should go after 2.5 flights because they go into a soft body mould, you know, on their fourth and fifth flight? Would you say after 7.5 flights at 540 on day, would you say stop the pigeon, it should go in the more?
I think you're about right there.
Because I'm a big believer in wings. They keep telling me it don't matter, but I've experienced it and it's, I've always worked on wings, wing theories.
Well, I'll tell you something, and I dropped one on this pigeon. It's it were in 05, a yearling cock.
Yep.
And he come back late at night from Pickerville as a young'un, and he fretted his second flight.
Second flight, yeah.
Because he went dark system.
Yes.
And he fretted his second flight. And I sent him. It was 14 days on eggs when I sent him.
Right.
And we're rushing about, and I was saying to him, I said, when he drops out of second flight, he'll. It'll do some damage, this pigeon.
Yeah.
And I missed him. I missed that he'd done it. And I sent him. He must have cast it that morning and he went.
So that fretted flight, once he casted it to his new flight, obviously then he got his old flight. Because they always say sometimes when they've had a bad flight, they're not so good the following year, don't they?
That's
if they've
right.
had any stress.
Well, he cast that flight and it were an hardish day and he come from Falaise. And he got second combine, and he should have topped it. But
how
far
would that be then, Brian?
For like 330.
Oh, three, yeah.
332, I think.
Yeah, about 312 to me, 313, yeah.
He dropped with a Scottish drag hen, and he was driving the roof, and he got beat with 0.23.
Of top it, so it just shows
combine.
You. It shows you that pigeon were right. And he got that flight out, which proved.
He cast that flight, he must have cast that flight during day as he was basketed on Thursday for that race.
It just shows, doesn't it? What about form spots then, Brian? You know when you look up the keel, and obviously when you get your skin pure pink, not black, does that make any difference on the form?
Look.
or your form spot as it goes up and down.
I never
the
look. I don't believe
but
it.
But you do believe in the wings.
Wings, I believe.
The
in.
Wings are a must. Yeah. What about?
I think. I shouldn't say this, but I think somebody spotted this, and they tried to make themselves sound important.
Right.
By getting on about these form spots.
I think pigeon tells you if it's right.
Oh, of course it does.
It tells you in
you
various
see it,
other.
It changes.
It changes in the way it goes right loft, the way it goes in the shed, and the motor. The character of the pigeon does change.
Changes to look at it.
But the wing, I do believe, is most important. What about looking out throats, Brian? Does that tell you anything?
Oh, it does. Looking out throat.
Can you tell it on
colour at throat?
Colour at throat, and when the pigeon is on form by looking into the throat, and when do you think? It is vital.
Something I like to see is a nice clean throat and
no phlegm at all, yeah. Just a nice clear throat.
Yeah.
No speckles or anything.
No, I don't like to see that.
What about eyesight, Brian? Have you any theories on eyesight?
Yeah, eyesight, I believe in it 100%.
100%?
For breeding.
That's what I'm going to ask you. I mean, I could tell you my theory, but it's Mr. Clayman's I'm wanting for the whole world to be listening to. Say for breeding now, obviously we know when you pay stock birds up. What type of eye would you pair for breeding? Would you pair a strong eye cock into a weak-eyed hen?
Yeah, you
like
want
a strong eye to a weak eye.
You want different eyes together.
Yes.
As to break up, I think.
That's right. Yep.
But I once had two green-eyed hens, mother and daughter. I've only ever had two. Yep. They were mother and daughter.
Right.
And the daughter bred me the cattle winner.
Yeah, 28,000 pigeons. Yep.
And the
what was she a green-eyed hen?
She was green.
Was she a very strong green-eyed hen?
Strong green-eyed hen.
What? Cock.
Right round a circle.
Can you remember what cock or what type of eye he was compared to that end to breed that?
He was yellow-eyed.
A yellow-eyed, but a lot weaker than the
A lot weaker than
yes,
her.
So it were different, that's what I'm trying to say, yeah?
And her mother bred me several pigeons.
But she was a similar type of eye as her daughter.
There was a great pigeon man in Sheffield, I don't know if you ever knew him or heard of him, Pat McGrath.
Pat McGrath, yes.
And Pat looked at them two ends and said to me, he said he'd never seen ends like them. Never seen eyes like them,
yeah.
And they were Delbar pigeons. And
yeah.
What two fantastic breeding ends they were.
Yep, so even now, Brian, when you're breeding your stock birds up now, you'd have a weak eye, a strong eye to a weak eye.
That's right. Or like if you've got a violety coloured eye, put that to a yellow.
Put it to a yellow.
You won't
batter up strength on them as long as it were one
opposites.
Yeah.
Yeah, opposites. But if you can get something like violet on circle, but if you can get a green, you're a lucky man.
You're a very lucky man.
I think so.
That's good, yep. So basically we've gone into, when you pair your pigeons up, what type of eyes you would like to be a top stockman, like you were yourself. I mean, some fancies keep saying they breed certain amount of pigeons and they're all good ones. But I mean, I've had quite a few pigeons in my hands, and it's never come to mind that every pigeon's been a good one.
I don't believe that. I've had pigeons all these years, and I've never.
You've had them and bought them off the best, bred them off the best. And what would your theory, Brian? And how many would you breed to start 2008 season? How many youngsters would you breed?
I breed 200.
So basically, every year you have 200 for yourself.
Yes.
Right, and you have 140. Is it on the darkness system?
On the dark system.
But you'll come to darkness system in a minute. We'll ask. How and when and why and what you do to race on that system. But so you have 140 on the actual darkness system.
Yes.
And then you have 60 on natural.
Natural.
So these are basically...
The natural system, we might not get that many this year, but I try to get me longer distance, or the pigeons that supposedly longer distance,
so
on natural system.
Natural, so hopefully they're going to have a more natural molt, even though it doesn't make any difference.
And I sometimes wonder whether it's right to do that, because I've had some wonderful dart pigeons carry on and win top prizes.
Yeah.
And I look at my natural pigeon, you're trying to get them down to the coast and they've got swallow tails and they've got flights missing and they've got the bare heads and that. And you think, well, wouldn't they be better going in this good condition as young birds?
Yeah, so they're not stressing them as much.
And this year I've bred some long distance pigeons and put them on dark and just going to see what happens.
That's right. So you start off with like 200, Brian. And how many decent pigeons would you say, even though there's nobody spends no more money than Brian and Mavis Clayburn, is there? You know, going to Holland, what you've done in the past, you're always looking for spending, you spent thousands, Brian, haven't you?
Yeah,
and how many would you say, after 200 pigeons per year, would basically be on the average of a tiny, you know, left at the end of the year, what you could say, maybe it's going to be a good pigeon or...
If I get three or four, I'll be happy.
Yeah. So obviously, they're not all good ones, as you know. So if this is year in, year out, over 40 years, Brian, you've gone through that method, haven't you?
People talk daft, in my opinion, when they start talking about all these they're producing, because it doesn't work.
Yeah.
You've only got to look at anything in life, look at horses. Yeah. Look at Mac Toombs, money they spend on millions and millions.
Yeah, that's right.
And how many Derby horses do they get?
Yeah, they're not all good ones, are they?
Oh, they're bloody hell.
They spend millions and end of day, they might come for one in a lifetime.
I mean, some people call a good pigeon a pigeon that wins a club race and is 50th fed. Not worth keeping.
but that, in their eyes, that might be the best they've got. So, you know, it's what. But in your eyes, on an higher level, obviously, it's not what you want. But in their eyes, it might be. It's basically a card winner.
We've got probably to race this year nearly 100 pigeons, old pigeons.
Old birds in total, and that's only three systems, isn't it?
I mean, most of them, we've a lot of yearlings. Not, you know.
That was another thing I'm going to mention, Brian.